Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 18th August 2018. The news articles we are going to cover today are these five. Let's see them all in detail. The first article is about nutrition. No child left behind. This article analyzes the nutritional status present in our country today. The article begins with giving some empirical insights about the nutrition status in our country. The National Family Health Survey 4, which was released in the year 2015-16, and the Global Nutritional Report of 2016, as well as the Global Hunger Index of 2017, shows the health status with respect to nutrition in our country. When considering Global Hunger Index, India ranks 100 out of 119 nations with a very low score of 31.4. With special consideration to children below the age of 5, wasting, which is low weight to height ratio, continues to be at 21% in the year 2017 when compared to 20% almost 20 years back in 1992. However, according to Global Hunger Index of 2017, stunting, that is height for age ratio of children below 5, has considerably reduced to 38.4% in 2017 when compared to almost 60% in 1992, which is a very significant improvement. Taking into consideration the mortality of children under the age of 5, according to both National Family Health Survey and the Global Hunger Index, the mortality has reduced from 11% to 5%, which is also a very significant improvement. However, taking the whole situation into picture, about 25% of India's children below the age of 5 are still malnutrition, which is a very important situation of concern. This is despite the fact that 7% compound annual growth experienced by our country in the past decade. India has also initiated several welfare schemes specially targeting children and other vulnerables including women and aged. But despite of the initiation and implementation of those welfare schemes, the nutritional status in our country is very poor and undernutrition is very high. For example, in the year 2008, special attention was given to the nutrition in our country. The Prime Minister's National Council constituted a special council targeting the nutritional needs of our country. In the year 2010, a special report titling Addressing India's Nutrition Challenges was submitted by the Planning Commission, which extensively analyzed the nutritional status in our country at that time. Currently, in 2017, with the change in the scenario, the government has come up with new schemes to target the nutrition sector. Few of such important schemes are National Nutrition Mission and Poshan Abhiyan. The Niti Aayog, which has been constituted replacing the Planning Commission, has also worked on National Nutrition Strategy, which specially targets 100 most backward districts in our country, prioritizing with special interventions for such districts. Other initiatives such as Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, which concentrates on cleanliness of our country, will also positively contribute towards improving the nutritional outcomes in our country. India is a signatory to the Sustainable Development Goals, so it must take measures in order to achieve the targets provided by the Sustainable Development Goal. Improved nutritional status and better nutritional outcomes are very essential for India to achieve its Sustainable Development Goal targets in a specified time. So, in order to achieve such nutritional outcomes and target, India especially needs to concentrate on three existing areas or programs. These three programs are of special importance because it targets maximum amount of the vulnerable population in our country. The first program is Integrated Child Development Services Program. This program has been existing in our country for more than a decade now, and it is a network of about 1.4 million Anganwadi centers all around the country. It benefits almost about 100 million beneficiaries, including pregnant women, nursing mothers, and children up to the age of 6. The second important scheme is the Midday Meal Scheme, This scheme was specially constituted to meet the nutritional needs of the children studying in the schools. This scheme benefits for almost 120 million children studying in schools in different parts of the country. The third important scheme is the public distribution scheme, that is the ration shops, which is present all over the country. This PDS scheme benefits almost 800 million people in different parts of the country, and especially under the constituted National Food Security Act, which produces food grains at very low prices for people under the below poverty line. The important among the currently existing schemes is the National Nutrition Strategy and the National Nutrition Mission. The National Nutrition Strategy, it sets very ambitious targets which are to be achieved by the year 2022. Some of the very important novel aspects of this National Nutrition Mission is using the information technology to better the nutrition status in our country. For example, it uses real-time monitoring of nutritional data in our country, especially for the children. It analyzes the nutritional data in order to map the nutritional gaps and address such a gap with respective welfare schemes. In a way, it uses the information and communication technology to holistically develop an online dashboard and to monitor the results to compare the nutritional status with respect to different parts of the country. Another currently existing scheme, the Poshan Abhiyan, it sets 3-year specific targets for different nutritional needs. For example, it seeks to reduce undernutrition and low birth weight by 2% each year from the current year, and also it seeks to reduce anemia among especially women to at least 3% by each year. However, the schemes which are existing in the past and these current schemes too, they suffer from few limitations. For example, these schemes are very silent on the constructive role which can be played by the private sector. These schemes are also silent on the roles of the development agencies and the civil societies, which can play a very crucial role in achieving these ambitious goals set forward by the scheme. Because of the above seen limitations present in the nutritional sector, it requires multiple sustained interventions over a period of time. These interventions must include accessibility to nutritious food throughout the year, portable water, importance given to hygiene and sanitation, primary health care, etc. Because of the multidimensional nature of the nutrition, the whole concept becomes a very complex issue. In order to address such a complex challenge, we need to simultaneously implement different policies. These policies must address insufficient and poor diets among different sections of the population, inadequate hygiene, sanitation, better management of diseases including the infectious diseases present in our country. India specially requires 3 urgent priority areas which needs to be addressed immediately in order to bring in a widespread change. First area is to adequately re-engineer the Integrated Child Development Scheme, the Midday Meal Scheme and the PDS for bringing in greater effectiveness in their implementation. For example, bringing in private partnership into the implementation of the welfare schemes like the Midday Meal Scheme is a positive step towards this direction. For example, if the public sector is brought in into the implementation of such a welfare scheme, the creation of framework and designing the framework, including the structures and the processes of the welfare scheme, will become very simplified. This means different parts of India has different nutritional needs. For example, North India will take wheat as a major nutritional component, whereas in South India, it's rice. Coastal communities may have different things as their staple diet, whereas the people living in desert area will have different nutritional needs. So, if private sector is bought into the dimension of such welfare scheme, then the nutritional needs of different welfare communities in different parts of the country can be easily tracked down, especially with the help of information and technology, and the matrices can be designed to implement and track the development of such nutritional schemes, which is a very beneficial scheme in our country. It is also very essential to bring in the local communities into the implementation of the scheme. Such efforts will also generate employment, especially to the rural youths, and it will ensure that there is minimal leakages in the PDS scheme, and which will benefit the welfare of the community. The second important priority deals with the fortification of crops. The fortification may include fortification of edible oil, wheat, rice and other dairy products in addition to the salt. So what is fortification? Fortification is addition of essential minerals and vitamins to the diet which we have in day-to-day basis. For example, all of us use iodized salt. This fortification of iodized salt is very significantly reduced the iron deficiency in different parts of our country, and this is proved empirically using multiple datas. In this sector also, public-private partnership can be bought in. In this fortification sector also, public-private partnership can be beneficial. For example, private sector can be used for fortification of staple crops like rice and wheat, which can then be made available through the public distribution shops. The third urgent priority is the campaigns which are to be conducted in order to increase the awareness about the nutrition among different sections of people in our country. This awareness programs can be conducted via multiple campaigns which can be used both for communication and education of people. This education must include broad areas of nutrition specific and nutrition sensitive behaviors. Such behaviors must include the importance of breastfeeding, the importance in practicing the diet diversity, importance of washing hands before eating, especially among children, deworming, safe drinking water, hygiene and sanitation. All of these will have important effects on the nutrition of individuals. It is also important that in order to bring in widespread awareness, nutrition must be considered as a commodity and it must be marketed. That is, it must be made interesting, engaging, simple and very relevant to the people via advertisements. Only if it is made simple, people will understand it, and the private sector in this can contribute very meaningfully. India is definitely improving in its economic front. However, the economic growth is not that useful unless the economic growth transforms and translates itself into social and human development. The second topic is Kerala's trauma. We all know that the state of Kerala is affected by flood for past 1 week, and it has caused widespread damages in both social and the economic front for the state. The overflowing rivers and dams and the massive landslips has affected the state to a greater extent. The state government has instituted various rescue missions, and still they are struggling to complete the assessment in different parts of the state. About more than 2 lakh people are stranded in different parts of the state, and about 1,500 relief camps are set up in different parts of the state. However, many people are not even in position to reach the relief camps. Several major efforts have been taken. For example, different combination of boats and aircraft by the efforts of Air Force, Navy and the Coast Guard has been sent to different parts of the state. Rescue personnel specially trained for this purpose have also been sent to ensure the safety of people in the state. The National Disaster Response Force, which has been set up under National Response Authority, has also sent almost 55 teams to increase the efforts and the rescue operations in the state. The disaster management units in the state as well as the other neighboring states such as Tamil Nadu and Karnataka has come forward to help the people of Kerala. Apart from helping, these states may also gain valuable experience of facing such a disaster situation in the future circumstances. The reconstruction of the state back to its originality is a very important task of the state government. So, in order to implement such reconstruction, especially of public building, residential homes, roads and the infrastructure projects must be given special priority. The reconstruction of the housing projects can also be implemented in the form of subsidized housing programs especially for the worst hit areas, by giving tax breaks to the residents suffered the most. The Chief Minister of the state has also used the information and technology platform in order to benefit the people suffering from the flood. The Chief Minister has set up online contributions to the Chief Minister's Distress Relief Fund via a special dedicated portal. Apart from the contributions received online, several other states have also started sending their relief material in order to help the people. Many control rooms have also been opened in order to coordinate different platforms in different parts of the state. But it is also important that integrating mechanisms via merging several cell phone numbers, especially giving one number for specific area, is very important in order to protect the citizens living in all the parts of the state. It is very important that the other states also take examples from such a crisis situation and enhance their capability in order to meet such a situation with minimal economic and human losses. The third issue we are going to see today is aerodrome would hit Chilka Lake's biodiversity. There has been a proposal by the Airports Authority of India to set up a water aerodrome in Odisha's Chilka Lake, which has stirred controversy. Aerodrome is nothing but a small scale airport wherein the flights can land. Implementing such a project in the Chilka Lake will definitely affect the biodiversity of the exclusive species living in the Chilka Lake. Chilka Lake is one of Asia's largest brackish water lake, and it is also a wetland which comes under the international importance category of the Ramsar Convention of 1972. If suppose the seaplanes In case of seaplanes running under the aerodrome project in the Chilka Lake, the birds which are living in the lake are at risk. The endangered Airavati dolphin, which is living under the lake, is very sensitive to sound pollution, which will also be affected because of the incoming and the outgoing of the flights. There is also another alternative proposed to this aerodrome project in Chilka Lake, which will be constituted in another place which is nearby the Chilka Lake called as Tampara Lake. You can locate Tampara Lake in map. This Tampara Lake is very close to Chilka Lake and it lies in National Highway number 16. The fourth topic we are going to cover today is with respect to micro, small and medium scale enterprises in our country. The MSME credit grows back at pre-note level ban, RBI study. The credit growth rate of MSME sector has been suffering for quite some time now, and this negative growth rate was accelerated due to the government's initiative of demonetization. After the implementation of the GST reforms, the MSME sector was significantly affected by the late processing of subsidies and other technological bottlenecks. However, the data of the RBI study shows that the growth rate in the MSME sector has rebounded and it is back into track to the previous level before demonetization. For example, the data of RBI shows that the bank credit to MSME has increased on an average of about 8.5% per year, which is the same level as 2015 before implementation of the demonetization reforms. It is very important to analyze the position of MSME sector with respect to the Indian economy on a whole. There are about 63 million units of MSME sector existing in different parts of our country. And this MSME sector employs about 111 million people. Apart from being a significant source of employment, it also contributes significantly to our country's gross domestic product. The MSME sector contributes almost 30% of GDP of our country, and within the manufacturing sector alone, it contributes almost 45% of it. The MSME sector also represents about 40% of India's total export. The last issue we are going to see today is civic bodies can raise more funds. Smart City Mission Director Kunal Kumar. The three important components of the mission, Smart Mission, is number one is improving the quality of life of people living in the smart cities, providing a robust economic growth leading to job creation, and also sustainability in the projects in every aspect dealt in the Smart City Mission. The Smart City Mission covers projects including smart agriculture, smart homes, education. It also talks about smart energy and bringing in smart grids. It also brings in smart aspects in governance, smart health including telemedicine, smart mobility like providing electronic transports, smart retail, open data, and it also touches upon Internet of Things connecting everything. And one of the important aspects of the Smart City Mission is to increase the share of the municipal financing of infrastructure projects. Though the 73rd and 74th Amendment was brought in by the government almost 20 years back, the municipal authorities are still suffering from significant financing issues. And this Smart City Mission seeks to address the issues in some ways. We all know that national GDP is a very well established process, but we do not talk about the city level GDP. This city level GDP data could significantly help the municipal bodies to make better developmental decisions in infrastructure project and the investment. It can also leverage the economic strength of the municipal bodies, which can in turn help the municipal bodies to raise funds, especially by using the market mechanisms which are available plentifully in our country today. Thank you.